Today, I'm going to talk about a very classic problem in optimization called the maximum flow problem. This problem originated during the Cold War. During the 1950s, the Soviet Union was this giant country and was America's arch rival. The Soviet Union controlled numerous Eastern European countries such as East Germany, Poland, Czechoslovakia, and Hungary. The US was very interested in understanding how quickly the Soviets could send supplies and reinforcements to Eastern Europe using its railway system in the event that a war breaks out in Europe. This diagram is from a paper written by the US Air Force in 1955 and was only declassified in 1999. It depicts the various railway tracks connecting the Western Soviet Union to East Germany. Here, a vertex is some geographic region, and an edge is a rail connection between two regions. There's also a pair of numbers on these edges. The bottom number is the capacity, and is an estimate of how many trains can move along this path in a day. So this edge can support 34 trains per day. The top number is a solution from the US military that determined that optimally there should be 29 trains moving on this edge per day. This number is called the flow. The military was interested in the maximum number of trains that the Soviet Union could supply East Germany on a daily basis. In other words, their goal is to maximize the flow into East Germany, hence the name is the maximum flow problem. This whole graph has 44 vertices and 105 edges, so it's quite complicated. The US military determined that the Soviets could supply Eastern Europe with 163 trains per day. Figuring out how to come up with the solution is the goal of this video. Let's start by formulating this problem as a graph. First, there are two special vertices. One vertex is called the source, and it's where the trains are coming from. To keep things concrete, let's say the source is a city, like Moscow. And the city that we want to send trains to is called the sink. Let's say this is Berlin. We can represent the other cities as vertices as well. Suppose we have Warsaw, Minsk, Budapest, Prague, and Vienna. And we have these edges representing the rail connections. Note that these edges have arrows, which means, for example, we can send trains from Minsk to Vienna, but not the other way around. Also, note that we only have outgoing edges from the source, so trains can only leave Moscow, and it has an unlimited supply of trains. Likewise, there are only incoming edges into the sink, which means trains can only enter Berlin. Finally, each edge has a pair of numbers. The number on the right is the capacity, which is the maximum number of trains per day that can travel on that edge. And the number on the left is what's called the flow, which is the number of trains per day traveling on the edge in the current solution. Right now, since the flow is all zero, we don't have any trains traveling on any edges. Given that the flow can't exceed the capacity, what is the maximum number of trains that can enter Berlin each day? Let's try to build a solution. We're trying to send trains from Moscow to Berlin. We can send two trains from Moscow to Minsk each day. We can't send any more because of the capacity. Now, the flow on this edge is 2 instead of 0. From Minsk, we have two trains entering each day, so we need to send out two trains. The only possible destination is Vienna. The flow on this edge from Minsk to Vienna is now 2. From Vienna, we can send two trains to Berlin. So what we did was, we found a path from Moscow to Minsk to Vienna to Berlin, and we sent two trains along this path, which is the most we can send due to these capacities. Now, we can do the same thing and find another path. One path is Moscow to Budapest to Prague to Berlin. We can only send a flow of 2 on this path to not violate the capacities. Along this upper path, we can send a flow of 2. And finally, we can send one train along this path. After sending flow on this path, we now have 7 trains entering Berlin each day. From this example, we can see that flow is just a number assigned to the edges that satisfies a few properties. First, the flow can't be more than the capacity of the edge, but it also has to be non-negative. We can't have a negative flow. For any vertex that's not the source or the sink, meaning it's not Moscow or Berlin in our example, the total flow coming in equals the total flow leaving. This is called flow conservation. For example, we have three trains entering Minsk, so there needs to be three trains leaving Minsk. This condition also implies that the total flow leaving the source has to equal the total flow entering the sink. Since the trains leaving Moscow can't stay in a city, they have to end up in Berlin. Here, we have a flow of 7 entering Berlin, but is this the best we can do? Maybe pause here and see if you can find a better solution. There's no direct path anymore from Moscow to Berlin where we can send flow. However, we still don't have the optimal solution. It seems like sending 2 trains from Budapest to Prague is a mistake. If we only send 1 train from Budapest to Prague, and then send 1 less train from Prague to Berlin, and reroute that train to Vienna and Berlin, then we can send 1 more flow along this upper path. So we can actually attain a flow of 8. But how do we design an algorithm to find this improvement? After all, just finding paths from the source to the sink doesn't seem to always work. Remember, our goal is to increase the flow into the sink while conserving flow for every node. And the key to a solution is realizing that although one way of doing this is finding a path from the source to the sink and increasing flow on this path, this is not the only way. There are actually many ways we can conserve flow at a node. In one case, we increase the flow on an incoming edge and the same amount on an outgoing edge. Another way is to decrease the flow on these edges. But there are other ways as well, like we can increase the flow on an incoming edge and then decrease it on another incoming edge. And likewise, we can increase the flow on an outgoing edge and decrease the flow on another outgoing edge. So there are multiple ways flow conservation can be preserved. Let's take a look at this graph. We can't directly push flow from the source S to the sink T, but we can utilize these 4 cases to get a larger flow. First, we can push flow from S to vertex 1. Now, we want to conserve flow at vertex 1. We have 2 units of inflow, so to preserve flow, we can push 2 units of flow out. This is case 1. Now at vertex 2, we increase the inflow by 2, but we can't increase the outflow. However, we can subtract the inflow of another edge by 2. This is case 3. At vertex 3, we subtracted the outflow by 2, and we can conserve flow by subtracting the inflow by 2. This is case 2. Finally, at vertex 4, we subtracted the outflow by 2, but we can increase the outflow of another edge by 2. This is case 4. Now, miraculously, we increased the flow from 2 to 4 while the flow is conserved at all of the nodes. In a way, we still found a path from the source to the sink, but we moved against the direction of some of the edges, and that corresponds to subtracting flow. This is the key insight behind a solution. We can find a path from the source to the sink where we move against the direction of some of the edges. This can still lead to a better solution. Let's go back to our original example where we had a flow of 7 going into Berlin. We were wondering how we can increase the flow to 8. Now with our new knowledge, we know that this is a viable path where we simply subtract flow from Budapest to Prague. This gives us the flow of 8 we saw before. It's helpful to create a separate graph that tells you exactly which edges you can travel on. This graph is called the residual graph. There's an edge in the residual graph under 2 possibilities. One possibility is there's unused capacity in the original edge, which means we can still send flow in that direction. An example is Moscow to Warsaw. We can still send one unit of flow in that direction, and this is indicated in the residual graph. Edges moving in the same direction are called forward edges. The second case is there's flow on the edge. There's 4 units of flow from Moscow to Warsaw. Now, we know it's possible to subtract flow, so in the residual graph, we have an edge from Warsaw back to Moscow, where we can subtract 4 units of flow on this edge. Edges in the opposite direction are called backward edges. Let's reset our graph so it has 7 flow entering Berlin again. What's nice about the residual graph is we can find a path directly from Moscow to Berlin, even though that doesn't exist in the original graph. The smallest number on this path, which is 1 in this case, is how much we augment the flow by in the original graph. If we follow this path in the original graph, we add 1 on the forward edges, but we subtract 1 on the backward edges. After updating the flow, we get a new residual graph. Now, let's apply what we just learned to come up with an algorithm. We know that a path in the residual graph lets us increase the flow, so let's search for one. If there is a path, we update the flow and then compute a new residual graph. Then we try to search for another path. If there is no path, we terminate. So this simple algorithm does work, and it has a name. It's called Ford-Fulkerson. Let's test this on our example, where we start with 0 flow. We find a path in the residual graph and find the minimum capacity. We augment 3 flow along the original graph. Then we update the residual graph. We do this until there are no more paths in the residual graph. Now, Moscow can only reach Warsaw, so there are no more paths to Berlin, and the algorithm terminates. And once again, we have a flow of 8. But does not having a path in the residual graph guarantee that we have an optimal solution? One way to see that this is optimal is to notice that since Moscow and Warsaw can't reach any other vertices in the residual graph, all of the edges leaving Moscow and Warsaw in the original graph must be at maximum capacity. The sum of these capacities is 8, which means that we can't send more than 8 flow out of Moscow and Warsaw. So that means we can't send more than 8 flow into Berlin, so 8 is indeed the maximum flow. These green edges form a bottleneck. This is what's preventing Moscow from sending more trains to Berlin. Finding this bottleneck is what the US Air Force actually cared about. They weren't actually trying to help the Soviets improve their rail network. They were much more interested in understanding which parts of the rail network to bomb in order to prevent the Soviets from sending reinforcements to East Germany. The rail network is a type of flow, but flows appear in all sorts of settings, like sending data across a network, or modeling traffic or electrical currents. It can even be used to solve another graph theory problem called maximum cardinality matching, which I covered in a previous video. There are also many other algorithms as well that improves on Ford-Fulkerson. If you want to see some of these more advanced algorithms in the future, please let me know. And if you want to stay updated, subscribe to the channel. I'll see you next time.